chains are caught. I've been saved. I don't have to do that, really. I don't have to come up with anything. The kids are coming up with ways in which they're seeing things and they're saying, hey, I know how Jesus fits into that, or I know how that can connect me to God. And praise the Lord for what God is doing. And just keep bringing your kids to church. We want them here. And I know sometimes it's crazy. Sometimes I've got five of them, okay? So I'm no stranger to that. But this is God's house. Jesus said, come unto me, little children. Come. And everyone is welcome here. And praise the Lord. I want you to stand, please. We're going to sing a song this morning that has to do, we're going to be talking about addiction today as part of our Biggest Loser series. And this song is a special song. You can go ahead and start it, Leonard. And if you don't know it, sing the words. Go ahead. United Methodist Church, we believe God has changed lives. Praise the Lord. And if you don't know that today, if you're not able to sing that with a heart full of praise, then I pray that today's your day. I pray today is your day. That today you will be set free from the chains that bind you. We're in the middle of a series we just started last week. Last week we talked about fear. This week we're talking about addiction, and the verse that's kind of leading us through this series of The Biggest Loser is Hebrews 12:1. I believe it might be behind me, and we're going to read this together. This is our verse that we're going to be walking through each week. So would you say this with me, church? Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Amen. That is, Jesus does not call us to do anything that he is not prepared to do that and to run the race well, as we lack the faith in a God who is able to break the chains that bind us. We lack faith. And today, my prayer for you is that you would get a good dose of faith and that you would leave here today lighter and freer than you've ever thought you might be, because you've placed your trust and hope in a God who does the impossible. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12, he said this amazing thing. He says, I will not be enslaved by anything. I will not be enslaved by anything. 1 Corinthians 6:12. Now he's talking to the Corinthian church. He's talking to a church in Corinth. And this church was what they call a carnal church. You know what the word carnal means? Carnal means fleshy. It means earthy. It means they were a church that wasn't really interested so much in the spiritual things of God. They were still, they went to church, but they were still very much addicted, maybe, to the things of this world. They were still very much apart and in chains to the things of this world, the things that pulled their desires and their passions in different ways. And they were a carnal church, and they were slaves to that. Instead of being slaves to God and to His Spirit, they were slaves to the life here around us, right? Anyone been out in the world today? Or this week? Yeah? Okay, so that's what's been kind of their God. And so he says to them, I won't be enslaved by anything. I won't be enslaved by anything. And what that tells me is we all have an it in our lives. All of us. Your pastor, you, our Sunday school teachers, our volunteers, our lay leader, our bishop, Our district superintendents, we all have an it in our lives. All of us. Some of us have multiple its. I'm going to have to remember what my father told me as a child to enunciate my words very carefully through this message here, because I'm going to be saying we all have an it a lot. Some of you, that'll hit you at about lunchtime. My it today is still very much pride. That's my it. My it is pride. Every day I have to wake up and I have to pray to God, Lord, make me more humble today. Lord, help me to see my need for you today. Help me, would you please reveal the wickedness in my heart that puts me above others and makes me selfish and want my way above your way. God, save me from pride. Pride is all through this body. It is. It's my it. It's an it that I'll battle and have to fight all my life, so long as I'm on this side of heaven. But every day God gives me grace and strength to be able to say no to myself and yes to him. I don't always do it perfectly. I don't always do it well. My wife will be the first to tell you that. But pride's my it. The other one is people pleasing. I want y'all to like me. I do. And sometimes God tells me to do things and go in a direction as your shepherd that I know not everyone will like or understand or please. And that's a struggle for me. It really is. I battle it. And I have to go to God and I say, God, am I trying to please them or you most importantly? And I hope, and I'm not going to get it right all the time, I know I won't, but I hope that at the end of the day I can stand before God and say, I've been your faithful servant, and he can say, well done. You did what I called you to do. Not everyone liked you when you did it. That's my it. Those are my two its. Pride and people-pleasing. There's another one. I used to have a big it in my life. The big it in my life was an addiction to pornography and lust. I used to attend meetings every week, and the way I would introduce myself is, hi, my name is Chad, I'm a sex addict. That was my it. Those of you who have been here since I got here in June, you know about that it, because I've been very upfront with it, but there's a lot of new faces here since June, and that may come as a shock to you. But by the grace of God, for 2.5 years, I've been free of that it. Completely redeemed. Yes. Romans 12:1 says, be renewed by the transformation of your minds, and God has done a mighty work in transforming my mind and my heart. The key to my heart is Jesus Christ, and he has taken what I thought was a huge it and would never be a I would never get around that one. And it's now a distant memory. It's a thing of the past. Now he shows me new its. Like, you know, now it's like, now that thing is out of the way, God is able to really, like, with laser-like precision, go into my heart and go, now that needs to go. That now needs to go. And I trust him that he can do it because he got rid of that big it. Right? He got that done with. Now I know and I can trust him. I can trust him. So when he says, hey Chad, that thing there, you need to lay that aside. Say, okay, God. Okay. What's your it? We all have one. We all have an it. Lots of them. Is anyone here a Hobbit fan? Lord of the Rings? What, two people. Boy, I thought they did a whole lot better than that in the movies. It certainly looked like it. So two of you admit that I just read the Bible, Pastor. So your it is lying. Is that what I'm hearing here? You guys have the it of lying. Yeah, thank you, thank you. Yes, so in The Hobbit, there's this character named Gollum, and Gollum used to be a normal person, looked like you and I maybe, and he got a hold of an it, and that it was this ring which held sway over him, and it began to drag him, and he called it my precious. Him is precious, that precious thing, that thing that he would die and he would kill for. He would kill to hold on to that precious. And the longer he held on to it and gripped it, the more his body began to disfigure and he changed and he became a monster. He became an evil it. He became, addiction, what addiction will do to us, addiction, the more we feed our addiction, the more it will feed on us. It will take everything we've got, and it will not be satisfied or happy with anything we give it. So you can just be swallowed up in it. It'll take everything. So what's your it? What's your it? Those of you who say, I don't have an it, your it is pride. All right? There it is. Those who say, I don't have an it, your it is pride. And so I ask you to join me in recovery from pride. Because I'm in recovery for the rest of my life from pride. But there's lots of its. There's its to things. There's alcohol, drugs, pills, pornography, money. Those are its for us. Someone here has that it. Some of our its are feelings. We have our precious is our feelings that we want to protect. Fame. Lust, greed, anger, depression, worry, anxiety, fear, thrills, pride, control, guilt, victim mentality, all of these things have become an it, and they can become our precious, which we hold on to, and we defend it, and it eats away at our lives. Next week, you'll want to be here because my wife, Amy, will be speaking about depression, and she has a testimony to share, and you want to be here. You will want to be here to hear what she has to say about depression and about God's power. Some of our it's are to stuff, sports. Yeah, I said it. I went there. TV. Clothes. Shoes. Yes, I'm pulling out all the stops today, everyone. Jobs. What? Pocketbooks. I didn't have that written down. That's a good one. Pocketbooks. Our jobs, our career, people, relationships, our spouse, our kids, our grandkids, religion. All of these things can become an it. It can become a thing in our lives which become our precious, and it takes us away from that which God wants to give us. It's the chains that bind us, and we begin to defend them and protect them, and we'll do anything to keep them. What's your it? We are guilty as a church in many ways, and I take responsibility for this as pastor. We are guilty of spiritual malpractice in our churches, particularly in America today, in two ways. And one of them I'll talk about in just a minute, but the first way that we are guilty of spiritual malpractice is we do not offer the proper cure to heal us of our its. And our choir sang about that today, about what the cure is. I know a man. Come on, church. I know a man, his name is Jesus Christ. And he can set you free. He is the cure. He is the key to your heart. He is the one who can deliver us and set us free from our its. And the problem that many churches today and many pastors are guilty of is this. We have all these it's about us, and what we do is we offer this superficial cure to them. We offer a band-aid to patch it up. We want people to just be nice and play nice, and we won't say the words, Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. Amen. 1 John 3:8 says, the Son of Man came to destroy the works of the devil. What are the works of the devil, you say? Anything which keeps me from achieving a relationship with Jesus Christ. Anything that holds me back from the freedom which Jesus died for you and I to have. Anything which keeps me from experiencing the love of my Heavenly Father. Jesus came to destroy that. So whatever your it is, Jesus came to kill it and set us free from it. Jesus is the cure. Jesus is the cure. In Jeremiah, I've been spending a lot of time in Jeremiah in my own personal devotions, and the thing that got God so angry to the people in Jeremiah in his day is that the prophets and the priests, he says this, he says, you go around and you heal the wounds of my people superficially by saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace. Jeremiah 6:14. You go around to my people and you say, here's a pill. Just take that. Peace. Peace. Here's a program. Just go to this program and here's 5 easy steps to get you out of your it. Peace. Peace. Our prophets and our priests today are offering more doctors and psychiatrists and therapists than they are the one cure, which is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came to destroy the works of the devil, and our inability to be free from our it is a direct correlation to our inability to believe that Jesus can actually set us free. We have more faith in our stuff than we do in Him to deliver us. What's your it? What's your it? You know, we all have disordered loves. You and I were born with this desire in our hearts. It's a package deal. When you were born with a desire to love the wrong things. Did you know that? You got kids, right? Some of you do. I know, because I saw about 30 of them up here. Did you have to teach your kid how to, like, mine? Did you have to teach them that? Did you have to teach them to want the things they shouldn't really want? Anyone? No. We gravitate towards that. We have disordered loves. One of the early church fathers, his name was Augustine. He said, we are all born with disordered loves. We're all just a mess. We love wrong things. All of us. We have disordered loves. And so part of becoming a Christian is reordering those loves. Now don't hear me saying this morning that you cannot love sports or you cannot love, what is it, pocketbooks? Don't hear me saying you can't love these things. The problem, though, is when those become a disordered love, when that becomes your precious, when that becomes your thing. So don't hear me saying you can't love those, but do hear me say this, and this is going to sting a little bit, church. If you would rather watch your favorite TV show than be in the house of God to worship with God's people, there's your it. If you love sports so much that it pulls you away for the majority of the year, away from God's house and God's people, there's your it. There's a comedian that does that. He goes, here's your sign. some of you know who I'm talking about, one or two of you. Everyone else I know is just reading your Bibles all week long, and you don't have time for comedians or movies. But there's this comedian who, when you do something stupid, he says, here's your sign. There's your it. If when you're hurt or angry or sad, and your first turn is towards popping a beer can or opening up your favorite website rather than opening your Bible and going to God in prayer, there's your it. Where do you go when it hurts? Where do you go when you're afraid? If when the waves get bumpy in life and your day isn't going the way it should, if you run to food or to shopping or go buy a new pair of shoes or a pocketbook rather than turning to God, there's your it. Our its are not hard to find once we start looking for them, right? Once you put it in that way, our its are everywhere. If after you get into a fight with your spouse or your friend, you go and you spend hours on Facebook talking to your real friends, rather than ask your Father in heaven to heal you of your anger and your pain and your hurt, there's your it. Anyone still want to just give up sugar for Lent? You see? Our loves are disordered. We love the wrong things. The wrong things become our precious. But this doesn't happen overnight. You don't just fall into this where all of a sudden, pornography becomes your God. That doesn't happen overnight. There's a spiral that happens. Psalm 1:1 says this. I think we've got it on the screen here. Blessed is the one who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. Psalm 1:1. Now in the Hebrew, this is a stair. If you imagine a set of stairs here, this goes deeper and deeper into it's a spiral of degradation. It's this more and more darkness. First, you walk in the counsel of the wicked, right? This is your person who just kind of walks by, and you see that magazine on the stand, and it catches your eye, guys. And you go, and then you keep walking. Right? So there's level one. And a lot of us might be there. You know, we walk by and it's kept. Level two is this. Stands in the way of sinners. You're walking by. You see the difference? I'm going to stand there and kind of check it out. You've walked by it so many times, and you've cracked the door open a little bit, and over a period of months, maybe even years, now you're standing in it. You're standing there. And then a period of time goes by where you're standing, you get tired of standing. You get tired, you wonder what you're missing out on. And You sit down and you're it. Lord help me. Have you ever sat and you're it? I did for a long time. For decades, I was sitting in a world of lust, in a world of pornography. I sat there and I thought, I can't be free from this. And the thing about sitting in this, the longer you sit, the more comfortable you get. And the longer you sit, the more your legs forget how to walk. The longer you sit, it becomes really, really hard to stand up. And you sit, and you sit. And eventually that just becomes normal. Soon you find other people are sitting with you. Soon you gather a company around you that sits there. Sometimes there are even other spiritual leaders, pastors, and teachers in your life who are also sitting, and they don't want anyone to stand up because, well, then they might have to stand up. Anyone ever been sitting in your it? I did for a long, long time. And it's a hopeless feeling. It really is. Because you might try different things for a while. You might try this or that. And soon you find that they just don't work. And you keep on just sitting down in it. And you just begin to think, this is just the rest of my life. I'm going to die sitting in my it. There's a story in John chapter 5. If you got your Bible, you want to turn there. Here's a guy who's been sitting in his it for 38 years. John chapter 5, starting in verse 2. Now, there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool. In Aramaic, it's called Bethesda, which has five roofed colonnades. In these lay a multitude of invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been an invalid for 38 years. Now, before you say, hold on, Pastor, you just went from talking about things like addiction and things like having all this stuff to talking about a guy who's an invalid who can't move and he can't walk and he's stuck and he's been there for 38 years. What's that? How's that the same? And let me tell you this. Have you never heard of a person who's suffering from some of the things we name? They say, this is just who I am. I was born this way. I'm just created this way. I'm stuck here. Have you ever met someone who can't do life because they're crippled, because of their it? Whatever it might be. Are you that person? Right now you know that you're sitting in it and you've been there for many, many years and you don't even know if you can be healed. You don't even know if it's possible. One man was there who had been an invalid for 38 years. Verse 6. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been there a very long time, he said to him, now listen to what Jesus comes and says to you and I today. Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be healed? What a glorious question that our Savior, the Creator of the universe, comes to you and I and holds out His hand and asks to us today, do you want to be healed? Because you see, Jesus knows. He knows that what's keeping us from reaching Him and the healing that we want is we love our sin. We sit in it so long that it becomes so normal to us that we begin to say, name it as our precious. It's that thing we love more than anything else, even God. And so this question, do you want to be healed? It cuts right to the heart of it because you have to either answer today, friend, yes, I want to be healed, or no, I'm going to hold on. It really comes down to that. Do you love your precious more than wanting to be healed? Do you want to be healed? Do you want to stand? Do you want to stand? Do you want to reverse this process? Jesus is coming to you today and he's saying, friend, do you want to be made well? I make you whole, he says. Do you want it? If you do, you're in the right place. Because he's calling to you today. That same question is asked of each and every one of us. Do you want to be well? Now, the first malpractice that I mentioned is that We don't offer Jesus as healer. We don't offer him as the way out. And there is, we can be delivered from our addiction, but we will spend a lifetime in recovery of learning how to use our legs again, because you've been sitting a long time. And so what recovery does, what a life of deliverance does, is it reverses this process from a person who's been sitting to help them to stand, a person who's standing, help them to walk. So the other, I said there was two forms of spiritual malpractice we as a church do. One, we don't offer them the cure. We don't offer them Jesus. And secondly, we do not offer the people, the places, and the processes to learn how to walk, to learn how to be free, to learn how to live free of their its. So that's something that we are going to work on. That's something we need to do. And if you're sitting in an it today, the thing to do for you today is, one, to say, yes, I want to be healed. I do. And the word we give that is repentance. It's to repent and say, I will turn again. I will turn to you, God. I will turn to you. John 4, 13 and 14 says this: everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. What have you been drinking from? What well are you drinking from? Jesus is saying to us, if you've been drinking from your it, you're always going to be thirsty. Has anyone ever been satisfied by your it? You look at one website. How many times did I say that's the last time? It's never enough. Anyone here satisfied with just one pocketbook? I don't know why you got me started on pocketbooks, but here I am. No. We keep going back to that well. We keep going back to it because we're thirsty again. An hour goes by and all of a sudden that itch is there again. And I got to go and feed it. I got to go and drink from that well. And Jesus says, anyone who drinks from this well, and he's talking about our carnal, earthly, fleshy wells, he says, you will be thirsty again. But anyone who comes to me, I will give you rivers of living water which will pour out of you, and you will be filled, and you will have eternal life. You will have a life of freedom from your it. Praise God. Amen. Jesus offers that to us. But the process of moving it backwards takes some time, because you've been sitting a long time and your legs are hurting and your legs are sore and you've forgotten how to walk. And so we as a church must offer the people and the places and the kind of processes that can help you learn how to walk again. It's not good enough to just offer here spiritual malpractice number one, to just offer them Jesus and nothing else. To say, would you just pray harder? Just read your Bible and you'll be better. And then we leave them alone on their own. And we wonder, why do they keep relapsing back into their head? Discipleship, becoming grown up in Jesus Christ, requires us to practice being disciples. Anyone here ever play sports? Okay. So no one's watched The Hobbit. One of you has played sports in your life. Okay. Come on, people, raise your hands. Who's played sports? All right. You've had a coach. How many of you have ever had a coach say to you, all right, guys, we got a game on Friday. Welcome to practice. Let's watch TV. And not game tape, just The Hobbit. No! Such a coach would be fired for malpractice. And we have church after church who says, okay, you've been sitting in it for all this time. and hey, come here. Here's Jesus. Have a good day. What do you do with that? How do you grow in that? So we're going to offer the people, the places, and the processes for people to be free of your it. If you're here today and you've been sitting in an it, on Thursday night, you need to be here at 7 p.m. to our recovery meeting. We have a Christ-centered recovery meeting that meets here every Thursday night. We've just begun, and we need you. We need you there. You'll learn how to walk. It's a step study where you will walk the steps up out of your it and learn how to walk with new legs and a new heart and a new mind. We need to help people do that. Amen, church?
Amen.
We need to become the kind of church that says to people with our doors wide open, you can come here because God is changing lives at Mountain View United Methodist Church. Thank you. And you can come here and you can not only be introduced to the cure, to Jesus, but we will also walk with you and take your hand and lift you up from your seated position so that you can stand on your own two feet, and then you can begin to walk so that you can go outside these doors and you can grab someone else who's sitting down and pull them over here because you know where the water is. Amen?
Amen.
That's what we're becoming, church. Amen? That's what we want. Is that what you want to become? Is that what we as Mountain View United Methodist Church want to be, a kind of people who offer living water to people who are sitting for 38 years in their it? Oh, that's what I want to be. That's where I want to go. Churches all through America are practicing spiritual malpractice because they're not offering Jesus as the cure, and they're not offering people, places, and processes where they can begin to walk on their own two feet. Walking in the Spirit and not in their flesh. We're going to teach people how to do that here. Thursday nights at 7 o'clock, if you have an it, come. We all have them. We can work through them together. And as we do that, I believe God is going to do something in our church that we won't even begin to recognize in a few years. I believe that God is going to open up our doors to where people are going to become pouring into here because they're going to hear the truth that, hey, you know what? I've been an invalid for many, many years, but I hear that people are learning how to walk again over at Mountain View because they're offering people living water there. Don't you want to be a part of a church like that?
Amen.
Oh, praise God. I need you. I need you. I need you to join me in that prayer that we would become a praying people who we will pray, God, make us the kind of people who want the people that nobody else out there wants. Would you pray that with me? Would you commit to praying that with me? God, would you make us the kind of people that want the kind of people that nobody else wants? We got a world full of people hurting. We got a church full of people hurting. We do. You're sitting in these pews. I know it. Because you come and talk to me. And I've been praying for you. And the grace of Jesus Christ, who set me free from the bondage that I was in, can set you free. You stand. We're going to sing a song you know, but it's a little different. It's Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Friend, if you've been sitting in an it for a long time, I want you to come and kneel before your Jesus, who right now is holding his hand out to you and saying, do you want to be made well? He will do.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
By everyone raising our hands and praising God. Can we do that? As our healer, our provider, our savior. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sins and for the sins of the world. Thank you for coming to break the power and the chains of the devil. God, I pray that you would begin a mighty work in our hearts. I pray that you would set us free, that we would be able to sing with upright hearts, "Our chains are gone." Lord, teach us how to walk in the spirit of your Son, Jesus Christ. Teach us how to walk and know the freedom that only you can bring us. God, make us the kind of people who desire to know and love and want the people that nobody else wants. And may they come flocking in droves to hear the sound of rushing living water, which comes from your Son, Jesus Christ. Go with us now. Bless us. Keep us in your name, we pray. Return us again joyfully tonight to sing and worship and learn more about you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And all of God's freed children said,
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace. Christ Jesus walks with you. Hebrews 12:1 tells us to lay aside every weight that clings so closely to us so we can run with endurance the race set before us. If you're carrying baggage like this, then it's hard to run. And we talk about shedding the weights that bind us and hold us back. I hope you'll see us this Sunday at Mountain View United Methodist Church. Come and join us and see how Jesus can set us free.